I'm going to make this, you know, start by the usual cliched, boring jokes about how to keep people awake after lunch, so that, you know, they know what to expect. Sanjay, you know, I was thinking, you know, there are space, you know, there are panels and panels, and here you have something, you know, that you're actually going to show us. Why don't we just put it out there and maybe make this panel a little more memorable in terms of they didn't just hear us talk, they actually saw, you know, what this whole thing is about. Can we request you to just put that on the board? Maybe that will get some more people, you know, from outside into this room. So over to you, Sanjay, if you just want to sort of put something out there.
Sure, I think I'll start with a brief introduction. And, you know, a lot of people think that space is complicated, or maybe, you know, few people don't really understand what are the different segments in the space domain. So I'll touch upon that and, you know, probably show some of these things.
Sure.
So, you know, I started building satellites when I was 18 years old. And, you know, today I'm running Dhruva Space, where we are a full stack space engineering solutions company. So if you look at any space mission, there are like three main components. You have the space segment, which is the satellite itself. Then you have the launch segment, which constitutes, you know, everything related to building a rocket to putting these satellites in space. And then you have the ground segment, which is used to command and control these satellites. So, you know, just to give you a small idea of, you know, what we do, at Dhruva Space, we build, you know, 1 kilogram to 200 kilogram class satellites. So, you know, the first thought that you would think of when you, about a satellite is, you know, it's probably the size of a small refrigerator, but, you know, satellites are much smaller these days. Like this small thing here, it's called as a CubeSat, and this could be used for a lot of different applications. People use these CubeSats for doing technology demonstration. So, you know, this was invented in the early 2000s, and today you see a proliferation of small satellites around the world. So you're looking at people launching hundreds of satellites in the low Earth orbit to offer communications and, you know, various sorts of solutions. So this is what we do on the satellite side. On the launch vehicle side, when I meant, you know, we build deployers, you know, this is the type of a deployer. So what it does is, you know, you put these satellites inside the deployer, and this thing sits on a rocket. So when the rocket reaches a certain altitude, these satellites are rejected.
Great. I think that was useful, and I'm going to request you to put this out there. Before we jump into the remaining questions, there are a few people out there who are a little more engrossed in their own discussions than the panel. I'm going to request them to just turn their back and maybe look here. Yeah, that gentleman who seems to have a complete back to the panel. Can we request you? If you don't mind, since the panel has started. Thank you so much. Sorry to disturb you. Ravi, I had a question for you. You have had this completely amazing journey from being a consultant in an international firm like Tower Parents. You come back to your family office, manage a $1 billion AUM. You're just back from Davos. You've heard a lot of international perspectives about India, about space story. How come you got into angel investing? What really made you look at Dhruva Space as a fairly interesting investment opportunity?
Well, all my life I've been working with corporations of a certain size,
right?
You know, and after that, after my journey in strategy consulting, when I came back to our family office, also I was directly on the seat to handle deals over a certain size. But what I learned is the reason why I migrate, I took interest in angel investing, is one, the ability to learn, and also the ability to unlearn some of the things that I had learned in my career and that were, you know, being disrupted, you know, my thoughts and everything. So that was a great opportunity to engage with young guys, passionate guys who are starting these new ventures and these new technologies. So that's how my interest started. And from there onwards, I took an active interest in handholding them, you know, where my perspective, my, you know, of engaging strategy with corporations was helping them grow, speed, scale.
Great. Just to add to the context for some of the folks in the room, Mumbai Angels has invested in Dhruva Space in a close to 4 crore that we invested around 3 months back. Ravi was the deal lead and has migrated to the board, breaking the paradigm of angel investors investing small amounts. He took a fairly big shot, you know, in terms of investing 1 crore straight into you know, Dhruva Space, which I would say, you know, reinforces and gives a comfort to a lot of investors, saying that, hey, if somebody's making a fairly large bet, you know, it's okay to be, you know, party to this investment. And I was asking Ravi, you know, in terms of how did he decide, you know, what was his decision-making process? And he said, look, I was, you know, I'm a phone call away and a WhatsApp away from Chad Anderson and Dylan. You know, people who have invested in Voyager, they're known as CEO of Space Angels, people who, you know, perhaps are in the capital of the space business. So it's no wonder that, you know, Ravi, you decided to kind of form your initial impressions basis some of the conversations you heard from those folks. Any insights from those conversations that you'd like to share?
Yeah, I mean, see, space is a segment that's growing pretty fast. And I don't see space as a business, but I see it as an enabler for multitude of businesses. And you know, in the future, space is going to play a very big role in almost every possible business that you can think of, every possible business.
Absolutely.
And you know, I mean, if you go back 20 years ago, what happened with the internet is very similar to what's happening with space today. In fact, just a few years ago, when I was in the U.S. and when people were taking calls with Facebook, I remember like people were asking, okay, there's this new social media platform that's being conceived and it's coming out in the market, but nobody knows how they're going to monetize it.
Yeah.
There's going to be a bunch of college kids who are going to have accounts on it,
right.
But how do we monetize it? And then they came out with a proposition to charge $1 per account.
Right.
You know, and that was their proposition, initial proposition.
True.
Today, you know, it's $550 billion enterprise.
That's right.
With an average annual revenue of more than $45
billion. Yes.
And this is just the start for Facebook. Everybody thinks Apple is big. Everybody thinks Amazon is big. Just wait till these companies just, it's an anti-fragile environment.
Absolutely.
With these businesses in the market. So,
absolutely.
So I see the same thing with space.
I would completely agree. On the sidelines, we were discussing and I was, you know, making this statement and saying, look, angel investing as it is perceived to be a risky asset class. And now look at angel investing in space. That's almost uncertainty to the power of uncertainty. And Mahesh said, look, I don't agree with you. Where's the uncertainty, right? And we can always rely on Mahesh to add, you know, to the fireworks to the panel. So Mahesh, over to you. Your take on the whole space. What made you really start Exceed? What was it when you got into it? What is it looking like now? Over to you, Mahesh.
Sure. So the history is, I mean, I won't really go deep into it. I earlier ran a fund called Seed Fund. We made investments in companies like Redbus, Carvalho and such. And then that was Seed Fund 1 and then ran Seed Fund 2, which had companies like Chumbak, My Dentist, Batsali and such. I mean, somebody earlier in the earlier panel was saying, you can't do B2C healthcare. Sorry, we've done a lot and we've done pretty well on B2C healthcare. So I disagree on that. Anyway, so it so happened that we happened to win India's best VC fund for both those funds. And suddenly we got a call from somebody in the government, the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, saying, would you guys like to look at electronics? And my first thing was to say, no, I'm not really interested. But they said, no, just go have a look and come back. So we spent, I sat with my partner, Farhan, who's not here. And one of the first things that came to mind was actually space. So in terms of history, actually, Sanjay and us go back because we, you know, Farhan and I have been kind of sort of mentoring them for the last 5 years. And we actually acquired this company and let it go out again out of one of our companies. So we know Dhruva from a long time. So look at space as a big thing. And the things that immediately stood out for us, why for us it was a slam dunk. So I don't know, for example, if you know that 35% of the world's satellites are launched from India. All right. Add to that India has no private space sector. Right? Just put those two together, that one-third of a $1 trillion industry is kind of dependent on India, and India has zero private sector organizations there. That immediately told us that there is an extraordinary scope for something to happen out there. Yes, of course, we have some regulatory issues, but if you look at the entire, every part of it, the really interesting thing in space is that there are almost no venture funds in space. We were the first fund in Asia, first in India, and the second in the world. There's one British fund which does about 100 million. We are about 65 million. All right. Which means that when we go around the world, not just in India, but we also go in France or Germany, etc., there are no other funds investing in space. So we have the pick of the best of companies from there, and many of them also want to have an Indian backend. Third, if you look at India, ISRO has been there for 57 years. If you look at ISRO and all the defense labs, DLRL, DMRL, DRDL, etc., we calculate that in the last 50 years, 150,000 people with expertise in space exist somewhere today in India. All right? And they're very poorly paid because they're all part of public sector enterprises. Put this all together, it says there is something that is out here that we need to do. So we actually started, we hired a few people from ISRO along with Sanjay's team, etc. We built our first satellite. We launched it on SpaceX. We tried very hard to launch it on ISRO, but you know, came up against a wall of resistance. We launched on SpaceX, figured out what to do in terms of regulation. We are still the only Indian company to launch into space. And then we figured out that there's an extraordinary business. So it's not as simple. I mean, I know what Sanjay said, that there's a space segment, there's a ground segment, and there's a launch segment. There's actually more. So even within the space segment, there's a satellite that goes into space. But what goes in the satellite? Are you putting communications there? Who's building that? Are you putting cameras there? Who's building that? What kind of cameras are those? What kind of chipsets do you have processing those images? For example, think about it. There is this new revolution. I talked about the economics yesterday where the rule is that we call it internally is half in five. The cost of everything is becoming half in 5 years, right? So today, for example, we can easily launch a satellite which is completely usable, including the launch cost for about, you know, 7-8 crores or 5 crores, which is one, you know, half of what it was 5 years ago, which is half of, and so on and so forth. It was, you know, more than 100 crores a few years ago. So given that now it's suddenly very affordable, there's a huge amount of potential there in right from imaging. Imagine if you have a long lens camera, imagine how hard it is to take a picture 500 meters away. Now imagine how hard it is to take a picture 500 kilometers away. Again, there's really interesting technologies to be built out there. Many of them ISRO has, is willing to commercialize. So in fact, one of our companies was the first company selected by ISRO to actually give its technology to. So we've got a technology transfer agreement where we're building 9 satellites for big satellites for ISRO. All of this just simply makes it a slam dunk. So it's a huge opportunity sitting in front of us. The economics are amazing because when you invest in a company, there's nobody else investing. So unlike .com or e-com where everybody's fighting each other and you know, everybody, if somebody's offering somebody 1 million, the next guy offers 2 million, even for a, you know, somebody in the bedroom with a piece of paper. Here, there's really not that much competition. So you can, you know, value a company fairly. And interestingly, you value it as almost like a manufacturing company because essentially that's what you do at the beginning, you manufacture. But as an end result, the output is a space company, which means you get higher, valued higher than dot-coms when you start up being invested at a cost lower than manufacturing companies.
True, true.
So that delta is huge.
True.
And in terms of proof, even in our very first company, from the price that we got in at, the next round happened at 27 times the price we got in at within 1 year, just to give you an idea. So this is just to give you this entire idea that space is not anything risky. It's just this extraordinary opportunity in front of you. All of you in Kerala will know better. ISRO is here. IISST is here. It's the only space college in university in India. Tumba is here, the very first launch pad. This is a perfect place for many of you to support the nascent space effort. I actually applaud what KSUM is doing because they have a special focus on bringing space into Kerala. So I urge you, everybody, to look at this as an extraordinary opportunity in front of your eyes. It comes once in a lifetime. Right?
Absolutely. Mahesh, I had one more question as an extension to that. Most of us would remember the famous cartoon that had come in Times of India a long time back. 3-4 Westerners sitting in a room, a poor guy from India with a bullock coming and saying, he wants to join the space club. And things have absolutely changed drastically. What do you think has changed, Mahesh? And then, Ravi, I would like to seek your perspective as well.
So I think we made a big noise about the fact that, with Chandrayaan, et cetera, the cost per kilometer was less than that of an auto rickshaw, right? While that may be true, and that may be true within our companies, I'm not going to charge less than others. I completely believe in charging international prices. So essentially, our margins are much, much higher. Like I was telling Ravi, the average margin in hardware in the space business, the gross margin is upwards of 90%, just to give you an idea, right? You are not going to find 90% type margins in hardware anywhere. And unlike a dot-com or an e-com, it's not eyeballs or GMV. It is you first give me the cash in the bank, then I'll build it for you, right? It's a reasonably safe business from that point of view. And when it comes to regulations, yes. So for example, I sit in the space committee. Sanjay is also there, the CII space committee. we don't yet have a set of regulations, and unlike what this gentleman said, a lack of regulations is actually okay. We were able to launch our first satellite from SpaceX by proving that India had no regulations. Right? They said, okay, that's fine. Then the absence of regulations means the presence of permission, and it was granted. Right? So we're working to make sure the next set of regulations is actually positive and in our favor compared to what was given out there. The opportunity is to build at Indian costs and sell at international prices. There's also a huge geopolitical opportunity. A lot of the business, a lot of the world that is ready to buy from space is there in EMEA, Europe, Middle East, Africa. If you look at the Middle East, Africa, Southeast Asia, they don't want to buy from China, especially Africa. For obvious reasons, China will take over the country, give a free loan, soft loan, take over the country. They don't like Trump, which basically leaves Europe and India. When it comes to Europe and India, we can price at anything between 1/5 to 1/20th the price and get the business, or 1/2 the price. Right? We have that ability. So we believe that there's a huge global market. So a lot of our focus is build in India, sell around the world, regardless of whether we sell in India or not, that's not so important.
Absolutely. Ravi, right straight out of Davos, the friends that you have from the space business.
I tend to agree and also disagree, but what I mean to say is ultimately you don't want to brand yourself as a low cost location.
Enough.
You know, I mean, obviously there are many solid companies that are coming out there who can match your prices and also do the job that you're doing. So you need to find the next frontier.
Right.
India, you know, India is a great ecosystem, obviously, you know, the ISRO and all of this, but then they also need to work on developing these private companies and, you know, leverage on this ecosystem quickly to, you know, build cutting edge technologies, because that's what, at the end of the day, how you provide this high end solution is what matters. You know, you don't want to be just keep sending satellites into space.
Right.
Because eventually it's about the solutions that you offer that matters, you know.
True. Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. Sanjay, over to you. You have just completed, fairly arduous task of raising funds from angels who had, you know, different levels of understanding of the space business. It was tough for you to even educate, have conversations, talk about constellations, talk about Earth stations, all of that. Do you want to quickly describe your journey? There are a lot of angel investors in the room. That is somebody who has raised funds from angel investors. How did that process work for you? What were the tough questions you were asked? Over to you, Sanjay.
Sure. We started the company in 2012. And, over the course of time, I tried to speak to different sets of investors. You know, when we started in 2012, we were the only company in India that was working in small satellites. That's when, you know, I met Mahesh and Farhan, and their inputs were really valuable. But, at that point in time, it was also that, you know, nobody had launched it. So, you know, it was practically impossible for anybody to believe that, you know, somebody could build satellites and ISRO is going to launch it and so on and so forth. So we tried different models, you know, we tried to talk to companies and show the value that we could create in India in terms of, you know, manufacturing and offering value addition, just like what Mahesh pointed out, right? So let's say you're manufacturing a hardware X in India, which costs whatever. In Europe, if you're going to do that, the cost of hiring people is higher, so on and so forth. So the margins are, you know, lower. So explaining that to strategic investors really, you know, worked out. So what I would see is a lot of multinational companies see the value in what Indian companies could do, especially from the hardware side of things. So this was one phase. And then, I wanted to raise capital to build the company. And, over this long journey, I kind of figured out that, you know, it's extremely important that you have paying customers. And, you go out and tell people that, hey, you know, this is what I'm building. Can you give me an order to build a satellite? Nobody's going to trust you because, you know, you first have to prove your applications in space, or, you know, you build a satellite, launch it, and then you show that you have heritage for these components. So for me, it was a bit difficult to, explain it to investors that space, you know, you need to trust, you need to first invest and look at the capabilities. I think in my case, I went with this idea that, okay, you know, I'm going to speak to as many investors as possible, educate them on what is happening. And I think MA, in all those sessions, I probably met like 160 investors. And trying to explain each one of them that, hey, you know, there's a long gestation game, but, you know, there's so much of value that we could create. We could build great products. And we could sell them at international prices. I mean, nobody is stopping you. As long as you have a great product and there are people around the world who are willing to buy it, I mean, it's a seller's market.
Yeah, I agree with Sanjay. I mean, the first thing, especially if you're a component or a hardware or a satellite manufacturer, is proof. So it's almost like if you're an architect and you want somebody to give you a job to design the house, the first thing the customer says, show me a house you've already built, right? So if you're a space company, the first thing when you go out there to sell a satellite, and we've been doing that, the first thing they ask is, show me a satellite you built. So literally the first satellite, the one we launched on SpaceX, we paid. So I had the dubious, honor of being the person who made Elon Musk a little richer because I paid him to launch our first satellite. But that helped the orders come. In fact, in our we have a launch in April, May, and 7 of our satellites are paid. You know, so we have 7 paying customers for an Indian company. The second thing that we found is it's really difficult to sell in space if you're alone, for a simple reason that you go to a guy and say you want a satellite. He'll say, yeah, sure, but what do I want on the satellite? He says, okay, do you want communication? Then you have to build a communication payload on that. What do you need to communicate? Well, you need to communicate, you need spectrum, you have to get spectrum permission, or you need ground stations. Or you want somebody to do imaging, he says, yeah, you need a camera, or you need lenses. What kind of imaging? You need somebody to analyze it. And after that, you need somebody to launch it and somebody to control from space. So it's never really just a component sale. There's an entire ecosystem that has to work with you. So one of the things that we decided as a fund is that we're going to fund the entire ecosystem, right? So we're going to sit back and say, so just like ISRO does everything, and we talked about this every day, yesterday, NASA does everything, we said we'll slice it into tiny slices. So we'll have a satellite company, we already have one. We'll have a ground station network company, we already have one with 2 ground stations. We'll have a radio payload company, we already have one. Optical payload company, we've identified 2 to invest in. We'll have rocket launcher companies. We have 4 that we are looking at, we're not going to invest in yet, because as of right now, somebody also announced that they had invested in a rocket launcher company in Kerala yesterday. They are illegal, by the way, right now, right? So we know that, okay, it's good that you've invested in an illegal company, but they can't launch from India, you can launch from outside India. We are working to first change the policy and then we look at that, right? Then there are launch pads you can manage. So we are looking to see if we can get land from one of the governments to run a launch. So literally every single part of it. In terms of space data imaging companies, there's one we've already invested in, there's 3 more we've got on the site. So it's literally the entire ecosystem. And the positive of that is all of these guys, we put money in them, we all have sales guys and say, all go out into the market. And if somebody wants imaging, it's okay, I want imaging, you say, okay, you need a satellite, you know, my sibling company makes that, you need a rocket launcher, that other company makes that, you need a camera, that other company makes that. So we're able to offer an entire solution. So every guy literally sells all the companies, or girls, sorry, not meaning to be sexist. So you have to take a slightly different approach. The minus side is it's a little tougher because you're actually trying to build an ecosystem. The plus side is, you know what, anyone hits, every single one can be a billion-dollar company. Space is a $1 trillion ecosystem. India is tiny in space. We are 0.2% of the world's. It's crazy. We launched 35% of the world's satellites, but the value of the space ecosystem in India is 0.2%. All right? There's even just that arbitrage is a 70x arbitrage to even get to our share. We are huge believers in India as a back end and the world as a front end to this. Geopolitically, everything works out. So it's one of those moments in space and time that we just felt we had to jump in. So to answer Sachin's question, I don't think it's risky. It's just one of those things in front of you. It's a lollipop saying, please pick me up and eat me.
Yeah, one additional point that I would like to add is, also in this entire journey, we kind of figured out that, you know, the systems that you actually build for these spacecrafts could have cross-sectorial applications. Like, let's say you're building structures using CFRP, and you have a setup that does CFRP. You could use that in other sectors. So you're actually building technology for space, but you could also use that and find customers in different areas. Like, technically, a lot of small and medium scale companies that supply to the defense, their components could actually be used in modern spacecraft. So, you know, as investors, I think you should also look at not just startups, but also, you know, SMEs who've been, you know, supporting the Indian space ecosystem. Yeah, so for example, you know, LASIK, the technology that you use, you know, the ophthalmologists use, this technology was invented by NASA for a specific application. That was for rendezvous and docking, like, you know, where a spacecraft goes and docks with a space station sort of things. But you see that in, you know, applications like medical and healthcare. Similarly, you know, Goodyear tires, they actually built you know, a strand that was used for parachutes. And they then used the technology and built the radial tires. So I think as investors, I would say, you know, space is a very interesting area. It's a $1 trillion market, as, you know, Mahesh pointed out. And there's a lot of potential. There are so many companies out in India who are doing interesting stuff. And what is missing is, you know, a lot of investors who could support these entrepreneurs.
I think that's a great point that Mahesh and Sanjay you just made. Considering that we are in Kerala, and, you know, Kerala is, you know, has always been the hotbed, almost like the pioneer, you know, if you can use the word, for the entire, you know, space movement. And like Mahesh was pointing out to me earlier, each state took a tag, you know, maybe, you know, Bangalore, you know, Karnataka had its own sort of USP for a long time. Clearly, space seems to be the USP, you know, for Kerala, the kind of investments that the government is making, the kind of, you know, focus that the government has, you know, has been showering on this vertical. It's extremely natural, you know, for folks in the room, for angel investors from Kerala, to look at space as a fairly, you know, serious asset class. In fact, I won't be surprised that after this panel, you have almost kind of made, you know, made the other sectors look very unattractive and the space sector to be more attractive. So I wouldn't be surprised if suddenly we have a rush of investors wanting to invest in space companies. Mahesh, one question that I wanted to ask you, we talked about the focus governments, you know, have been putting in. What has been done? What more can be done? Any take that you would like to share with us?
So I think there's a big policy shift that has to happen at the central level. So right now, for example, because ISRO did everything, ISRO is kind of waking up to a dawn where it has a bunch of people like us who are doing stuff elsewhere, you know, and it's trying mainly to hold on to the entire business. So we are working very hard to say, look, ISRO is just another vendor. You know, much like at one point in time, the government made some stuff, you know, nobody else was allowed to make. So this is not a license, Raj. We're trying to de-license it. That's on the one front. But on the other front, for example, states can really be helpful. So there's one state that we're talking to where we said, look, can we build a launch pad? Can you give us about 100 square kilometers by the sea, etc.? And they're actually pretty open to it because that's what it kind of takes to do this if you want to build an entire economy. Because trying to get ISRO to give up its launch pad is going to be difficult. So build another one, all right? So we are working at the same time by nudging ISRO, by doing stuff outside ISRO, but also nudging them to say, we'll work with you. I think that's we've kind of figured out that you have to do this kind of push-pull thing. But also in terms of investments, so I remember what the IT Secretary of Karnataka did to build up the entire IT-ITES business in that state, which resulted in Infi, Wipro, TCS, etc. I would really love to see Kerala do that for space. All right, if that is a, you know, every state has a kind of priority. In some ways, I think Telangana, all three of us, by the way, historically are from Hyderabad, has a huge defense and industry. You know, there's at least 500 companies that provide stuff to defense and, you know, DRDO that are spin-offs from the entire defense infrastructure. Probably Kerala can do that for, if it wants to focus itself as, you know, as a space community. That's one thing it can do. The second thing is to, so one is regulation. So there are lots of regulations that you can make easy and open out here. Second, to get ISRO into the process out here locally, if not, you know, to pass your own laws. Third, to provide funding. Somebody asked me at the Space Conclave last week, what can Kerala do to get more Kerala startups? I said, look, frankly, if you look at it, all of us, I mean, companies are in Hyderabad. You know, all of us, our companies are there. You know, there also we have a couple of companies in Bombay, etc. While Kerala has a history, you have to be able to attract companies out here. So give some financial sops, do some co-funding, something of that sort, right? Make an effort, you actually have the ability to do that. And the third thing is to be able to get more of the overseas companies in. So Airbus, Thales, Boeing are all dying to come into India. They're not able to get into this business elsewhere in India, but they're open to the idea of Kerala. I mean, theater, because God's Own Country and all this extraordinary European tourism that's happened last 10, 15 years is very well known in the European world. And a lot of the global leaders in space are the same European companies where the individuals who come on holiday, they understand theater very well. So use that goodwill that is already there, or you don't just dissipate if you don't do too much.
Mahesh has summed up very well, but I would just like to add one point to this is, I think our country also needs to get into more agreements, you know, with different regional cooperatives, you know, like this morning I was seeing that, you know, one of the industry bodies and with the government and MEA had an agreement with the Caspian country, the Caspian region. All of these Kyrgyz, Kazakh, you know, all of these countries. So, see, ultimately, you know, there are invisible walls in this world. Okay? We know it or not. There is walls between West, East, you know, regions. So you need to break these. You need to have these international cooperation. So Indian ecosystem can be better leveraged. Indian companies can get into high value things. Like, you know, the money is in providing high value solutions. You know, and I think the government has to proactively reach out and make these agreements.
I think another compliment that I would like to add here is, I mean, do not shy away from investing in space companies, because, you know, don't feel that, you know, regulations are a barrier, because for space companies to start with and to do something in space, regulations are there, but they're not really, you know, kind of stopping people from doing things. So do not shy away and think that regulation is a barrier, because that is something that will eventually fade out. And today, you know, we have paying customers to whom, you know, we are building products.
Absolutely. For all of those folks who are in the room, just bookmark this date. Whenever you make the space investment, whenever you decide, you know, that you're going to embark and take the first steps, remember this, that you are in this room. Thank yourself for being in this room when you are with this August panel, comprising of Sanjay Nekanti, Ravikant Reddy, and Mahesh Murthy. A round of applause for all the panelists, and we conclude the session. Thank you so much. Thank you very much, panelists, for the fantastic session. We just have maybe a 1 minute for maybe if the members from the audience want to ask a quick question. Because soon we'll have bouncers being sent here to evict us from the stage, if anybody has a quick question. Or we could take it offline, if that's fine. Once again, Mahesh, thank you so much. Thank you. Ravi, thank you so much for being here. Sanjay, thank you so much, and for getting the deployers and the satellites. Thank you
kindly
so much.
Hold on, sir. Kindly hold on, sir. Kindly stay back. I would like to request our curator to kindly hand over mementos to our panel members. Thank you very much, Sri Ravikant Reddy, Angel Investor, and by Angels. Thank you very much, Mr. Sanjay. To Mr. Mahesh Murthy, Founder and Director, Exceed Space. Now I would like to request you, Mr. Faisal from KSUM, to kindly hand over memento to curator of the session, Mr. Sachin Karnik, President, Mumbai Angels. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for that very, very interesting session.